Welcome to latest TV news. I'm Mark Walker. We're going to start today's news by getting an update from Councillor Martin Osborne, a Green Party councillor on Brighton and Hove City Council. Here it is. I'm here with Councillor Martin Osborne, who is the councillor, Green Party councillor for the Hollingdon and Stanmer ward. Welcome back, Martin. It's been a while. I think last time you were here it might have been before you were elected. So that is some time ago, isn't it?
I think we had an online
talk last year
during the pandemic from my living room. But yes, it was, I think, 2 years ago was the last time I was actually here.
Yeah, so welcome back. We're going to talk about the Tech Committee. Tell us a bit about what Tech Committee does, because it's quite important, isn't it? It's got a bit of a mixture of culture and obviously technology, a bit of planning as well.
Yeah, so Tech, it's T-E-C-C. So it stands for Tourism, Equalities, Communities and Culture.
Yeah.
And my co-chair is Councillor Steph Powell, and she looks after the Equalities and Community side. So that's anything ranging from community safety to our library strategy, but also she's been dealing a lot with the fallout from RISE being decommissioned. So there's been a lot of work that she's also done on the anti-racist strategy that we signed up to last year. So that's her side of Equalities and Communities. But the sides that I've been leading on are the T and the NC, so the Tourism and Culture side. So yeah, that's anything from the visitor economy, which is very important to the city, employing a lot of people and bringing a lot of money into Brighton and Hove, and the cultural side. So that includes the Fringe, the Brighton Festival, Brighton Dome, the Brighton Centre, but also sports and heritage side as well.
Yeah.
So it's quite a diverse committee, but there's also a planning policy as well, which is another side that the committee considers. So it's one of the five policy committees, so it's quite an important committee, and as I say, quite a diverse set of different areas which we look at.
Yeah, I know you've got this sports strategy, but let's start off with that, because I spoke to a few councillors all saying that they've got brand new updated sports equipment in their park. So is that part of your overall sports strategy for their city?
The main strategy that's came forward earlier this year was the sports facility, for the investment in the sports facilities across the city for the next 10 years.
Yeah.
So there's been a lot of discussions about the King Alfred going on for now a number of years. But what this plan is looking at is a more holistic understanding or review of what is in the city, what facilities we have, where the gaps are, and trying to put in an investment plan for where we will put the investment that comes forward. So where do we want swimming pools in the city to happen? Where do we want our football pitches? Where do we want, if there's going to be investment in other types of sports? So that plan sets it all out, and we've got a working group set up which we're starting tomorrow. So we've got our first meeting to scope out what it's going to look like over the next few years tomorrow and kicking it all off. But it's going to be millions and millions of pounds of investment in the city. And I think, as I said, some of the sports facilities are aging and old, so we do need to invest in them for the health and well-being of everyone.
So give some examples then. I mean, because obviously we're very lucky, we've got a world-class football stadium in the city. So we're getting sea lanes down at the seafront Olympic-sized swimming pool there. What else? What needs improving in the city?
So, we don't have enough swimming pools.
Yeah.
So Sport England set a number of metres per squared of how you're meant to have for the number of residents.
Yeah.
And we're below that, so we do need more swimming pools. The sea lanes is a good addition, but I think it's mainly meant to be for those people who are more professional, more at a higher level of sport, to train for like triathlons, and maybe when the time when they can't swim in the sea, potentially going to sea lanes. So I think that's going to be more on the of those of a higher level of sporting rather than more leisure pools. So we do need to have more pool facilities. So where that is and where that could be, that's to be considered in the investment plan. But I think we do have the Amex, which is a good stadium, and it's hosted events before, and we'll have the Women's Euros next year, which we're really excited about.
Problem. All right, we're going to leave it there, Martin. Out of time. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
We'll catch up again with Martin soon. Join us then. We now hear from latest TV news reporter Minnie Dobre. She has a report on the Centre for Contemporary Arts. Here it is.
Brighton CCA has commissioned an exciting new exhibition by artist Nika Nilova, examining our cultural relationship to water. Let's meet Nika and find out more.
This installation is comprised of casts of the interiors of various pipes that I've recovered from demolition sites, and it's basically picking up the internal sediment of the pipes that was clogging them up over time. And my interest was to kind of unearth this ubiquitous structure that connects various architectural bodies together, like through plumbing, various houses and places are all connected, and it's underground, it's hidden from the eye. So I was interested in unearthing it and bringing it up to the surface. It's very similar to how arteries and capillaries connect organs in the body.
Where did you first get inspiration for that, or first realise the sort of how they were both connected, the two?
So the first time I actually thought about pipes was on an archaeological site in Santorini, and it's one of the oldest archaeological sites in the world, and it was preserved because of the eruption of the volcano. So something really destructive as an eruption of a volcano actually managed to preserve elements of a civilization that would have otherwise have disappeared. And there, the interesting thing of this site is the volcano ash and the lava have preserved various objects, and by covering them they've created molds of these objects. And later, when the site was resurrected in the 20th century, they've recovered these objects by pouring plaster into the volcano ash and therefore finding the objects again that would have disintegrated inside. And so there was one of these pipes that was completely clogged up and recovered through this plaster casting technique, and it was just about that big, but it has all these layers of sediment inside. It was handmade, and it was just such a fascinating object, and you can see the entire archaeological site and how these pipes ran through the various houses, the layers, the various architectural levels, and that's where my interest began. And so for this installation, it was kind of an attempt to zoom in on a fragment of this architectural underground network and bring it to the surface. I think in installation it is very interesting to create a more immersive space, and this specific room is interesting in a way that it's completely isolated from the outside world, and so you do feel like you're entering from the surface and then you are in a completely different world. And so for me, this was all kind of building it on several layers from the ground up and creating like an all-encompassing site where all these objects exist, but you also feel like you're not you're not in a regular space. You feel like you're underground somewhere.
So I guess a big part of the way that you can see in here, I mean, we were just talking about the pieces on the floor, is this sort of idea of layering and moving through the space, but also moving through, I guess, I mean, you've talked about sort of time and different sort of layers of geology and all this sort of stuff, which is why it was important to have lots of things balanced up at height in the space, because this is a very sort of tall room. But we were trying to use this space to make it feel quite immersive, as you were saying, when you come into the space. But as you come through the exhibition, sort of broadly, I think we're moving uphill.
Yeah.
Is that right? Up through the layers to the surface.
And also all the sculptures, they are referencing different times, like the roundels are particularly referring to Roman architecture and plumbing, and these come from some from Victorian pipes, some from contemporary pipes, and so it kind of becomes a collage of various time zones where the past and present kind of intertwine, and you sort of move back and forth in time. And yeah, this is the ripple stone. Is when you move closer to the surface, this is a ripple stone subsurface. There are two works, the other one is on the other side of the wall, which is the actual surface. And these are made by imprints of the hand. And again, I was quite interested in the connection between the human hand and something that is of the human proportion with a larger geological realm, and creating a stone-like geological surface.
It runs until the 22nd of December, yeah. There's a whole programme of events and talks that run alongside it. You'll be able to see that stuff online via the Brighton CCA website at brightonCCA.art and on Instagram as well.
And do you book a ticket to come and see, or is it?
No, you can just come along.
Thank you so much.
And it's free.
That's it for the first half. Join me for the second half, where we'll get a news report on Kropotkin, and we also hear from Councillor Robert Nemeth on Busgate.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.
Welcome back to Latest TV News. I'm Mark Walker. We now hear again from Millie Dobray, who has a report on Kropotkin.
Welcome you here. Hopefully you'll have a good evening. I'm not going to be with you for the whole evening, but you'll have a good evening of music and dance, but also that we will learn a bit more about not only Peter Kropotkin, but also about some of Brighton's radical socialist history and our future. So thank you very much.
I picked up a pamphlet in, would you believe, W.H. Smith's in York Railway Station, Workers in Stalin's Russia, by Emil Bonnery. And it was a very well thought out and analysed piece of work, which showed that actually workers in Russia were no better than those in the West. It wasn't a workers' paradise. They too were exploited and overworked and underpaid.
Bring us in the R.A.T. Safety jacket, she knows. It's time to blow the whistle and shout.
I heard somebody say to the person next on, oh, I shouldn't take any notice what he says. He's an anarchist. You know, I'm 29 years of age. I didn't know what an anarchist was. You know, excuse me, mate. Are you an anarchist? You know? And he said, yeah, I'm an anarchist, you know, all that.
In matching pastel lilac, comes trotting down the stairs.
I'm a member of the Fair Trade Steering Group, and one of the things, this is a voluntary, unincorporated group of people who've come together because they passionately believe that the people who produce our tea and coffee and cocoa should be paid properly.
So we queue up with the pigeons, students, kids and moms.
Follow Kropotkin's politics, or I don't know, Luxembourg's or Hardy's, the point is that he saw that change only comes through people organising themselves. I think that's true regardless of, you know, your exact opinions on anarchism or Marxism or whatever it is.
We're intrinsically a part of the natural world. Okay? You know, we're completely dependent on nature.
My view is that a decent social democratic views cooperative views have to take influences from not only pure Marxism, but also from anarcho-syndicalism, anarchist thinking, and cooperative thinking to be able to understand the world that we live in.
It's not just history, is it? You know, this stuff's going on now. Brighton remains somewhere where there is a high level of protest. We are a city that will mobilise if the fascists turn up. You only have to look, I mean, I live opposite the bin depot, so you know, I've got down to the picket lines. The power remains there, that if the people who do the work stand up for themselves, nothing gets done until they've won their demands, which those guys have.
So Kropotkin was in exile here in Brighton. He wasn't called a refugee, because the term refugee is very much a 20th century term, but he was in essence a refugee.
The most important aspect about humans is that we're cooperative. And he used the word mutual aid was to help other people, to support other people, to cooperate with each other.
If everybody does a little bit to help each other, that's the idea of solidarity and that's the idea of mutual aid. Thank you.
Word is one. Stop sneering.
But grows on a green tree. A strong man and his crystal eyes is a man born free. The oxen pass under the yoke, and the blind are led at will. And a man born free has a path of his own and a house on the hill. And men are men who till the land, and women are women who weave. 50 men own the lemon grove, and no man is a slave.
Peter Kropotkin, Brighton and Hove, Justice House.
So long live Kropotkin, long live the peaceful revolution, mutual aid, solidarity.
And finally for today, we hear from Councillor Robert Nemeth on location around Valley Gardens. He talks to me about Busgate. Here it is. So I'm here with Councillor Robert Nemeth for the Wish Ward from Brighton Hove City Council. We're here to talk about Busgate, not Watergate this time, Busgate. Tell us what this is about. Because it's quite an interesting kind of traffic layout we've got here, and it's leading to a lot of people getting fined.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. So I've uncovered at the last meeting of the Council's Transport Committee that 9,600 people are being fined every month for driving through a series of so-called bus gates, this is one of them, around the Valley Gardens in Brighton. And that works out as over 300 a day, or you might think of it as one every 2 minutes. My argument is this device is designed to actually stop motorists driving past it. But just as we've been standing here, we've seen a number of people doing it. So it's clearly designed wrong. The council knows this. They've collected over £3 million now. So they clearly could have put a stop to it, but perhaps the fee that they're getting in precludes them from fixing it. And that's the argument that I'm making.
Public cars go along here and they have to turn up Trafalgar Street, but many are just going straight through onto London Road. Is that right?
That's right. So any vehicle coming up or coming down has to turn here, or they get a £60 fine, which is reduced to £30.
Yeah.
But the markings aren't clear, and I make the case that if an engineer wanted to fix this, they easily could, but they haven't done so.
As cars approach this point, you're saying the signage isn't as good as it could be, and a lot of people are actually almost being tricked into going straight past into the bus gate area, thereby getting fined. You're saying signage isn't clear enough?
Yeah, it's not just about the signage, it's surface treatment, approach to the junction, the fact that a tall vehicle might be in front of you so you don't see the sign that's coming up. But essentially, it should be that everybody's told to turn off and buses and taxis would know not to. Yeah. So they don't need informing because they're professional drivers who just wouldn't do so. But yeah, it should be made very clear everyone's turning unless professional driver.
And there's bus gates all around the Valley Garden scheme, isn't there? So I mean, I think they've been around for quite a number of years, haven't they? It's not a new thing, a bus gate. It's in the highway code, apparently.
Yeah, there's no problem with... I mean, Churchill Square... has a bus gate. Entrance to Churchill Square is a bus gate. Nobody's complaining about there being a device that stops non-buses drive through.
It's just signage. So what could be done in a council level? I know there was quite a heated exchange, wasn't there, recently in Brighton Hove City Council?
That's right. Well, the Conservative group, of which I'm obviously the spokesman, made clear that this isn't acceptable. The Labour group and the Green group seemed to agree and then voted for it to continue. So we're in one of these bizarre situations where a problem's been pointed out, but those who are in power, which is the Labour-Green coalition, have not done anything about it. I'm saying it needs fixing, obviously.
Yeah, exactly. So what's the next steps then? What do you think can happen? I mean, it seems...
Well, the next steps are we'll watch the council letting it continue and we'll watch motorists just continually get ripped off.
Yeah. How much money has been raised in so far through these various bus gates? I think there's four around.
Yeah, well, it works out as £3.5 million pounds a year, and we haven't had a full year of it yet, so we're high fractions of that year.
Yeah, okay. And then obviously you're going to be speaking to the council. So do you think it can be rectified? I think clearer signage, is that what you're calling for, really? Mainly the clearer signage?
If they're stuck on rectifying it, I'll happily submit a design. But it's easy peasy. It's easy to rectify. You just have to choose to do it.
Yeah.
Any traffic engineer would... It's like primary school stuff. Easy.
Yeah. Okay, we'll leave it there. Councillor Robin, thanks for talking to us today.
Thank you.
That's it for today. Join me tomorrow for more of your local news stories. Goodbye.